Okay, so tonight we are so excited. We have Jessica Abel here, who's written Out on the Wire. She is joined by Roman Mars from 99% Invisible and Glynn Washington. I'm gonna bring them out in like half a second. Jessica is also the author of two textbooks about making comics, the graphic novel La Perdida, and she's working on a science fiction comic series, Trish Trash, Roller Girl of Mars. So thinking about that, let's welcome Jessica, Roman, and Glynn.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Welcome. Oh, look at that. It's great. Okay, so why don't you tell us who you are and what you do and maybe how long you've been doing it and the origin story of your show. We'll start there.
The origin story, oh, that was something that was really hard to figure out, to let go. I really wanted to put that in the book. It didn't fit, but.
My name is Glynn Washington. And I'm super glad. So there's some snappers in the audience. I have maybe one of the most unlikely origin stories in public media. There was a This American Idol style contest, and I won. And about 2 years after that, we got to pull the trigger on the first season of Snap. And I'll take it over to my brother here, but just to know how, if you ever wonder, someone says Glynn is not wise, he doesn't know what he's talking about. My first hire was me.
That is true. That is very true.
So I cried real tears when he said he was leaving us forever.
And so I'm Roman Mars. I produce 99% Invisible. So I started 99% Invisible as my night job when I was working at Snap Judgement. And it just sort of snowballed into something that began to require my attention. And that's how it really began, is this little segment on KALW. Into this podcast and this whole thing that it is today. It's amazing to me at this point still.
And just to go how incestuous this is, one of the early inspirations for Snap Judgement was a show on KLW called Invisible Ink.
Which, don't applaud that.
Which, I saw a t-shirt here earlier. Oh, right here, yeah. which was started by Roman Mars.
Yeah.
Circles within circles. No, circles seriously. One day I want to tell your origin story in comics. So I've been making comics for 25 years now, sort of unbelievably, and started out doing fiction, entirely fiction, doing short stories and doing mini comics and stuff like that. And then I started doing some nonfiction in the 90s, and it was as a result of that Ira Glass called me when I was living in Mexico City in 1998 and asked me to do Radio and Illustrated Guide, which is a 30-page floppy comic that we put out in 99 about how This American Life made and really still makes their show. What are the stages? How does it actually go through this process? And then I left it for 15 years or 12 years or something and did a whole bunch of other stuff, including more fiction comics and two big textbooks on comics, and then teaching storytelling for 12 years. And all of a sudden, it seemed like a really good idea to go back and look at what was going on in radio, since I had been thinking about storytelling so intensely, basically, since Radio and Illustrated Guide.
And what was your process in writing this book? How did you decide who to interview? How did you do that?
Well, I had a meeting with Ira Glass and Seth Lind at This American Life, and I was talking to them initially about expanding Radio and Illustrated Guide, and as soon as I brought that to Ira, and he's like, oh yeah, good idea. He's like, what do you have in mind? And I was like, I don't know, like 100 pages, you know. He's like, no, absolutely not, because it's so much work. Like, the first book was just so much work. And he didn't want to get involved in that again, which I completely understand. He's a busy man. He was creating cereal, doing other stuff. But so we revisited the idea, looked at it again, and both he and I thought about it a little bit. And I don't remember who came up with this idea, but I don't remember. It might have been him who said, why don't you look at other shows that are doing other stuff now? And so we talked about a list of who we thought was doing really great stuff. And they helped me get in touch with Glynn and the Catherine Burns of The Moth and Jay Allison for The Moth Radio Hour and who else did I initially get in touch with? With Planet Money and so there's a short list of initial shows that we talked about, and then it kind of expanded out from that a little bit. So when I found out about what Roman was doing, which was during the research period, I got in touch with him immediately and wanted to talk to him. And initially, I wanted to get in touch with you to talk to you about your time with Snap. Right. But while this was all going on, that was when your show was really becoming like a full show. And so it kind of grew from there.
Great. And I want to share, we're going to share a lot of Jessica's illustrations throughout and panels from the book. There's going to be some audio later, and I totally want to make sure we capture everyone. So here, all right. We've seen her, Jessica. There is Glynn and the Snap Judgement staff circa 2012.
Yeah, so my initial research round was in 2012 in the summer. I was out here in June, I think, 2012, and then did some more follow-ups and research throughout that fall and winter, basically. So it's, you know, and this is something we can get back to talking about, but it's definitely, like, it captures a moment of transition, I think.
This makes me very angry.
You look like a superhero.
Oh, no, I'm great, but this is the thing. I mean, a lot of us up here owe Ira a lot. Ira Glass, he's very, very encouraging, helped us out in a lot of different ways. I used to owe him a lot, should I say. I used to owe him, but now he owes me because he took our Stephanie Fu, and I do not appreciate it. It's true. Sorry.
It's a fact. It happened.
And here's Roman. Okay. So we're here to talk about specifically storytelling on the radio and podcasts in narrative forms, but also a lot of the lessons in this book and a lot of the things that Jessica covers in her interviews are about storytelling that applies to everyone, no matter who you are or what kind of stories you tell. So we're going to talk about that. We're going to talk about specifics of Snap Judgement and 99% Invisible. And hopefully we will gossip about Ira Glass, which we've actually already started to do. And we'll have lots of time for your questions. And Roman, Glynn, and Jessica are going to engage each other in conversation as well. And what we are trying to figure out is how to make radio that's good. That's a younger Ira Glass in the front, and I believe an intern in the back, Jorge, who is in the audience tonight.
Jorge, where are you?
20 years later.
You have to say hello, Jorge, Oscar.
Oh, wow. All the way in the back. Sorry about that.
There are seats over here. this is an amazing, the people who are at this show, it's kind of an amazing, you know, confluence. You were talking about Nancy Updike, she's in the doorway there. Jorge's in the doorway. Julie Snyder is sitting with the glasses there, and she's still their senior producer. And then on the other side there is Elise Spiegel, who's Invisibilia. So this is 1999. This is their entire staff in 1999. Yeah. This is everybody. Well, it's not everybody. They actually had an office manager who was extremely helpful to me named Todd Bachman, but that was pretty much it.
And that's a DAT tape, in case
you want to know. Yeah. I actually had to put a footnote on that. Like, not on this page, but there's a thing where we said talk about the DAT, and I was like, DAT tape, we don't use those anymore.
Yes. So can you tell us what a DAT tape is, for those of us who don't know?
Digital audio tape.
That's it.
It's a cassette tape that holds more stuff at a higher resolution.
It was a bad piece of technology that I'm glad is gone.
All right. Good. And not everyone has read your book yet, Jessica.
What?
I know. They will.
Wait, I thought that was a prerequisite for getting a ticket. You didn't give a quiz?
There'll be a quiz as you leave, so you better start taking notes. Can you tell us who you wrote the book for?
Who I wrote the book for? Mm-hmm. Well, I wrote the book for, I guess primarily for people who love this kind of narrative nonfiction radio. I mean, that's the core audience. Not just people who want to make it, although the first book, Radio and Illustrated Guide, really had a sort of like, here's how you make this thing kind of angle. But this new book isn't really that. It's meant to be much more broad, expansive kind of audience where, you know, millions and millions of people love this stuff and listen to it every week. And I wanted to help them understand, why do they love it so much? Why do they sit in their driveways instead of going into their nice warm houses and listen to the end of the stories? I mean, this is it's like a cliche, the driveway moment, but it's absolutely true. It's totally happened to me. This style of storytelling, I mean, there's so many different ways that it can be done. It's not like one style, but like this overall kind of approach, so powerful and so interesting. And I wanted to try to reveal, what are the secrets of the new masters?
Me? Yeah.
And we're waiting.
For me to say something about, what is the secret for? I have no idea. I read the first comic book religiously. It was like the Bible to me, to get into like how to make radio, because there was nothing else like it. It was amazing. And to think that, I don't know, what is it? I guess it's 15 years later, to be in like a second version of that just totally blows my mind. So anyway.
Cool. So yeah, I mean, that's the core audience. And then, you know, even larger audience is people who just want to know about storytelling. Because the fact is, once I kind of got into this whole thing and sort of pulled apart these threads, I feel like 90% of what's in the book applies to any kind of storytelling at all. Exactly. especially me, you know, like as a cartoonist, I, until very recently, had never made radio, never made audio. And so the process of writing the book was also a process of learning myself what I needed to learn from these guys. And you'll all be very modest about this, I'm sure, but like the thing is, I'm not sure that if you're in the middle of it, you can kind of like see what all the parts are, you know? Like it takes somebody from the outside to look at it and say like, oh, this is what you're doing, and this is like this person, and this is like this. This is different, this is interesting, but you know, mm-hmm. and kind of put all that together. And I had that response from a lot of the people in the book, like, I knew all this stuff, but I didn't know this stuff. You know, it's kind of not laid out in that way. And I felt the same way as a storyteller. Like, as I knew all this stuff, I had done many books before, written many stories, but having to really think through, how am I gonna put this down on paper? How am I gonna take these pieces apart? Help me make the book itself, you know?
And what were some of those themes that emerged from the different shows, sort of things that came across in your interviews?
Would you like to show us some artwork?
Maybe. Let's see.
Surprising, engaging characters. Authentic voices, which this is not.
Shit.
Robust narrative structure.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
Sorry.
And in many cases, intricate uses of sound as a part of storytelling, and especially right here.
Speaking of sound,
should we have some sound?
I think we should have some sound. We didn't really, who wants to go first?
Please go first.
We'll do it. So we want to play, we're going to talk about sound, but it's good to hear back to back the two shows for examples. So here is.
But the baby had to come out premature. Mother and child were whisked to a neonatal intensive unit, and only parents were allowed to visit. I was not a parent. But the daddy was on the other side of the world trying to find a plane, and my friend said, I need someone here. So when the nurse asked me, are you the daddy?
Are you the daddy?
I told her, yeah, I'm the daddy. And the nurse, she told me to scrub my hands with soap and the special brush before she took me to the incubator. And she looked like a little baby bird, hooked to tubes and wires and monitors, so tiny. My friend, the child's mother, took my hand. I told her to go to sleep. Go on to sleep. Are you sure? Go to sleep. She finally left, and the nurses told me that what the baby, what a tiny baby under 2 pounds really needs is skin-on-skin contact. What can I do? They told me to strip. They set up a tent, an anti-contamination tent, and sent me wearing nothing but my boxer shorts inside.
So that was Snap Judgement.
I changed my mind. I want to go first.
And here, exclusive, I think you get like 12 hours before being released tomorrow is the first minute of tomorrow's 99% Invisible.
This is 99% Invisible. I'm Roman Mars. It was the night of March 30th, 2005, and the Powerball jackpot was $25 million. On TV, the white ping pong balls rolled out one by one as the host announced the winning numbers.
22, 28, 32, 33, 39, and your Powerball is 42.
That's producer Avery Truffleman.
And there was a winner in Tennessee. But the way the Powerball drawings work, there are usually some second place winners who guess all of the numbers except for the very last one. On average, there are 3 or 4 of these players.
But on March 30th, 2005, there were 110 second place winners.
Was there a computer glitch that played all the same number? Like, has someone compromised the system?
This is journalist Jennifer Aitley.
Lottery officials are panicked, you know, because like something is up.
So the next day, as the winners around the United States came to collect, the Powerball officials asked them,
so where'd you get your number from?
And each of them had the same answer. They had gotten their numbers from a fortune cookie.
So the stories, both of the stories obviously are leading to very compelling things, but I want to focus on the sound and how you choose, how you chose, how you came up with what your show should sound like, uses of the different elements and ambient noise and stuff like that. So,
yeah, the idea behind Snap in the beginning was to have this idea of dual narration. You can't really divorce the sound from the story, but the idea was that let's get rid of the boring stuff and go right to the story. And in order to do that, we needed cues to drop listeners into what we're trying to say, both kind of emotionally and sometimes even intellectually. There's a lots of things. So when we pitched this idea, we called it dual narrative audio conceptualization of some nonsense we put down there.
And what is that?
Yeah, all it is
catchy.
This whole idea.
It is catchy.
It's this brand new idea of story and sound combined. And it's the sound that, what's happened actually is that unlike the time period, I think that first DAT tape that Ira was holding in the first picture here, the technology of sound creation has changed tremendously. For a typical Snap Judgement sort of soundscape, we will have maybe 12 to 14 different tracks of sound. And it's second by second as far as the editing is going. This, even now, Ira wouldn't know what to do with that. It's a different world, and it's still changing now. And it's just the tools that we have to produce sound with right now are so different, and the idea was to let's go see if we can stretch them to the 11th point and make this show.
I got totally caught.
I mean, I think it's really cinematic what Snap Judgment does. And that's one of the things that I remember from the very beginning, was the use of Foley sound and music that blended together in this really beautiful way that I hadn't heard on the radio for a long time. And when it was done, it was usually done pretty poorly with, like, you know, horses with, you know, coconuts.
And stuff. So what...
Right, in that scene that you just played, there's like this really mm-hmm. subtle sound, like hospital sounds that come through.
Right.
And they're not, you know, I've listened to that story a number of times. And, you know, I've never really thought about that, you know, and yet I feel like I can feel the ICU, you know, feel that hospital room. And that's what it does, is it really puts you right in that space.
We're lucky in a different way as well. And I say about this technology that goes into creating this sound, there's also been a shift in the culture in that you have sort of, we've become a headphones nation. And if you put on your headphones, I've got you in a different way than any radio producer of yore has ever had. It's a doing this motion right here, now you're in our world. And what we're trying to do is go ahead and take up every, you know, every possibility of that, because the last thing we want you to do was do this.
So I'm reminded, when I think of sound on radio shows, what I often think of with the sound effects is sort of the Prairie Home Companion, clippity-cloppity, clippity-clop, right? So how do you go from that to what you do? Is your team using totally different techniques? Is it an aesthetic difference? What's the difference?
Yeah, it's definitely an aesthetic difference, for sure. But it just depends on the story. And I think we were talking about this before. The radio producers, the audio engineers that work with the show right now are just great geniuses. And so my job is oftentimes to get out of the way. And it used to be like when Roman and I first started the show, I would do a lot of the score. We all had to score each other's pieces and everything like that. And what I found is that oftentimes I could score someone else's piece better than they could, and they could score mine better than I could, because we're hearing different things. And to give a story, like we talked about this in the book, to give your story to somebody, I just worked on this story, you go ahead and score it. Don't screw it up. I just worked really hard on that. Don't screw it up. That's especially because it's so fast. We don't have a lot of time, and you're not ready to give it away yet. But developing the mindset, it's like, okay, this is yours now. Go and do with it. Interpret this. You're going to interpret it differently than I would, and I think that it just really helps make the story more broadly appealing.
Collaboration is key.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And with these guys, I think in particular in the beginning, it was just me, Glenn, and Mark. And Mark did a lot of the scoring and set the template for a lot of the style of that Foley and that cinematic sound. And he had no baggage from radio whatsoever. And it was, I think, really important to that show. Like, I think that was really critical. And I remember him using music in ways that I was just like, we don't do it that way, you know? And he was right, because that was, and they were finding a new way. And so that's why it's still a joy to listen to Snap Judgment. And I've worked, Pat Mesiti-Miller, one of your guys who does a lot of your sound design, did a recent piece for us because we just wanted a little extra edge. It was it had these underwater scenes, and we just felt like he could really make it sing. And I got the thing back is like 22 tracks of buses of this going to this and this going to this, and it was a terrifying octopus of a session to figure out. But they have that every episode, every story. It's really amazing.
Thank you, Borman. I can't do it anymore. The truth of the matter is, what you just mentioned about Pat Mesiti-Miller, who's the head of our sound, I just can't do it. I can't do it as well as he could. I used to be able to come in and act like I knew what was happening. I'm the boss, man. Those days are over. Don't tell Pat that. Yeah.
So Roman, coming from SNAP and, well, while they're figuring out 99% Invisible and starting that, what was your vision for the sound?
Well, I mean, there are a few things. I mean, the reason why 99PI exists a little bit was because I was a reporter for a long time, and one of the things I loved about SNAP was it sort of stretched me and turned me into a pure storyteller, but I'm just didactic by nature, and I like reporting.
Didactic by nature.
Yeah. And I missed just explaining things. I like explainers. That's just what I like to do. And so I started creating these little stories, and they're not really stories. That's the secret to 99% Invisible, is that it's not really stories.
They sure sound like stories.
Well, they have a beginning, middle, and end. And sometimes they have story structure and characters the way normal stories do. But they're often just about ideas and concepts, especially in the beginning. They were like 4 minutes long. So it was just like an idea, a couple of nested anecdotes, and then maybe something funny. And then we got out. We were done. I say we. At the time, it was just me. And then as it developed and we added people, and you know, Sam and Katie and Avery came, they have a story sense. They want to tell stories too, but they love the explainers. And so a lot of the design is kind of trying to fool you into thinking it's a story when it's just like a random assortment of things about a subject. And so the rhythm of it.
No, the thing of it is that he's absolutely right, and I can see how being in a SNAP situation would have been so difficult for Roman.
It was joyful. I loved it. But it was a very different style.
It's a very different style. I think it's really, really important. I mean, I obviously deeply respect this brother for lots of different reasons. And when we talk about different things that we prefer in storytelling, that's not to disparage anyone else's style. I don't think there's enough styles of storytelling that are out there, and there is so much room for other people to leave their mark right now. Mm-hmm. But the difference right now that we're talking about is very, very, it's really built into radio right now. What Roman is saying is he's going to explain these things to people, and he does such a beautiful job of it. I just listened to that thing going to the bottom of the ocean.
Yeah.
Again, it was just beautiful. And for us, we would have to actually have a mic on that guy's face before we do that story. And so, because we want to be really, really close. And the last thing I want is an expert to come and tell me what the story means.
And I love experts. I remember our first argument about a piece. Was this one about the end of the online world, the Sims world.
Yeah.
And I wanted that Stanford guy in there.
Yeah.
And you did not want him in there at all.
No. No, if you haven't heard it, it's one of the most beautiful pieces. It's called Game Over, that Roman Myers did for SNAP and for 99% Invisible as well. But it's a beautiful piece. Oftentimes, this is what I think about storytelling in general. I will say, this is not the case with Roman. But general and public, and especially public media storytelling, is that we get in the way of our own spell casting. That storytelling itself is you're telling the story and we get into it and you're there and there's so many ways to screw it up. And one of the ways that is traditionally done is just right when you're feeling it, just right when you're doing it, I get it, they bring out an egghead. A professor so-and-so from such-and-such university to explain to me what you just heard. And it drives me nuts. It drives me nuts. Because I think it's a problem within our field in that we don't trust our own storytellers. We don't feel oftentimes that a regular person essentially can make news. And his perspective is valid. And what we're trying to do a lot at SNAP is say, let's get rid of the the academics, the big guys, the rhetoricians, everything like that, and let's focus on this one person's story from their perspective and give it as much attention and weight as we can. Now, I say that to say that a lot of times people mess that up. A lot of times they don't. They get it right, and oftentimes what Roman does actually is get eggheads to tell stories that are interesting. I don't know how he does it, because I can't do it.
Well, that's a lot, to circle back to the sound design, that's a lot of what I'm trying to do. So I try to create this space, and the miking and the intimacy of that space is about you feeling those things, even though it isn't a plot-driven story. It's sort of an examination of an idea. And so it kind of seduces you into caring about these things the way you would in a really riveting story that is sort of naturally there where you're driven by plot. And so that's part of what those tricks are about. And a lot of it is the rhythm of, and this is something that I totally took from Radiolab, that rhythm of like, of making it interesting to the ear by having me come in, reporter come in, the subject come in, back and forth, and then sort of like the interviewee talks to the reporter talks to me, and I talk to you. And there's something about that connection between me and you, the listener, that is what I'm trying to create there when I don't have something as life or death, like that happens on his show.
It's something that like showed up in your show, and also in the book it shows up in It's Planet Money. And it's Radiolab, and all three are like shows that are essentially about ideas, right? Yep. Essentially about, and there's plenty of stories to tell. I mean, you run down the storytelling aspect, but it's like, often it's the story of discovery, or it's the story of how this came to be, or there's.
I mean, when I say there's no story,
there's no protagonist.
I mean, it's a little bit different than the typical story.
But this is what I struggle with all the time, trying to explain, you know, like with this book, there's no protagonist. It's the story of how you make stories, which is an idea. So it's like, yeah. But you can do it.
Yeah.
And it can be awesome.
So were you making the show and then you kind of realized, oh, when it kind of happens this way, it works the best? Or did you go in very intentionally thinking, I think, let's try this?
I mean, the thing was that at the stages I started 99, I was really intentional about it. I don't mean to make it sound canned or designed to an extent that makes it phony. But I was like, I want to be 40% Radiolab, 40% Memory Palace, 10%. I had this idea of like, what would work for this type of subject? And it was because I'd made radio for 10 years up at that point. Like it was my little project to see if all these things that I had been working on came together in this way. You know, I think that the show has gotten better. It's been going for 5 years now. The show has gotten better, but I think you hear the nature of the show from the very beginning. It's changed a lot and developed mainly because the staff is so good that it's just gotten so much better because of them. But I think you feel the bones of it are right there from episode one. So.
And. Glynn, is there a snap? What would your snap formula, has that changed over the years, evolved?
No. I think much of the Roman. I mean, we want to get better, and we certainly I hope we're doing that. The snap was actually born in a lot of ways as a reaction to what I was hearing, as I told you before. This idea, especially that the communities I knew anything about weren't being represented, I thought, fairly in public media or any media. I thought that the spell casting was being broken just ridiculously, randomly, for no reason. And I also think this is it, this is what happened. This is what happened in public media. Thanks to Jessica's book and other things, really having to do with Ira, all goes back to Ira. Ira came up with a template of what public media stories should sound like. And it goes like this. First, I'm going to give you a little bit of exposition. I'm going to give you a little story. I'm going to give you a little reflection. Story, reflection. Story, reflection. Conclusion, bow. That's This American Life. What I wanted to do was go, what the problem that I had with this oftentimes was that it put the producer or the reporter in a position to judge or from a God-like position on everyone who was involved in the story. And I wanted to see what would it be if we moved the focus down so that the storyteller, whoever lived this thing, could tell their own story all the way through and not be judged necessarily by some Eastern educated reporter. Now.
Play into the hometown audience.
Western educated reporters,
yeah.
Too.
At the end of a piece, the end of a story is magic. There's a gap. There's a gap at the end of every single story. And this gap is where you either kind of nod to the story and go on about your business, or you take this story internal to yourself. And again, we screw this up all the time in public media. And what I wanted to do there, instead of, if I tell you at the end of a story what a story means, I rob you of that story. I rob you of your ability to take this to internally. If instead I find a way to almost to finish this story so that you feel emotionally satisfied, but ask almost as many questions, not answering any questions. Life isn't like that. I want to, at the end of the piece, have the protagonist doing whatever it is they do. Essentially, I will lead you to where they are, but I'm not gonna make you think anything about it. I want to end the story essentially with a question. And if you end the story with a question, now it's your story. You own that story, and you're thinking about it in a different way than if I told you what it meant. And so it's a different type of a story structure, and it's one that I'm actually pretty adamant about. In fact, the LA Times said I'm combative about it. That's how they do black people. But a combative storyteller. But it's really important to us, actually. But what does this say? We do work with the cross section of America. Yeah, we try to do that. America. Listen, the high idea of having. Listen, what happened? Listen, there's a show on the radio where someone said, someone said something, and then what we do in public media is we interpret for our public media audience what this lower socioeconomic person just said, so that make sure we're all the in crowd together, me and you. I hate that. I hate that because America is smart enough to understand its own America. We are smart enough to speak to each other and understand what we're saying to each other. We do not need to be interpreted to, and it really gets in the way of the overall narrative that we're trying to make oftentimes. And that's, again, one of those points where you stop the spell casting and you just mess it up for no reason. And I say that, I mean, with love, because these are the people who taught me, I mean, how much I do care about what stories sound like and bringing other communities into it. And I know now, I know for a fact, this show's not gonna work, we have people around the country who can't understand it. The show plays well in West Texas, in deep Mississippi. You can play a story from San Francisco about a transsexual stripper in deep Mississippi, and nobody calls and does anything about it because it's a story that person is coming from someone else's heart to another person. It's not asking for a polemic. It's not political. It's just like, this happened to me. And it's so wonderful that we're able to do this, that especially when you listen to what's happening right now in our political debate, where you have several jackasses right now braying at each other on TV. And we get to actually tell stories, and at the end of it, you know, you've seen this. When you watch Crossfire, and you watch these two idiots yell at each other, and you want to go take a shower. It's happened to all of us. But when you listen to a story, when someone actually says, this is what happened to me, this is what I did next, and you get a picture of a world that you've never seen before, oftentimes, if it's told well and done properly, you don't want to just bathe. You want to do something. You want to get up from that chair and participate. You want to go see the experience that they're talking about. I remember listening to a story recently on another show. Now I want to go see a Mexican wrestling match because that was a pretty cool story. I want to see how it works in real life. This is the power. I'm going on, but this is. It's really important right now that we understand that this form can really be inclusive, and get into each other's head, because what's lacking in this country right now, I think, is empathy, and what storytelling does is bridge it.
I feel really great right now because I feel like I actually captured some of that in the book. I got it right. And in fact, in episode 3 of Out on the Wire podcast, yes, there's some quotes from you about this exact thing.
All right, on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
So.
You gonna follow that one? No. What are we doing
now?
Well, we were
not at all.
We were going to talk about Roman storytelling. How you effectively.
That's uncanny, isn't it? I mean,
so, how do you do it right? How do you do the explainy thing right and not, you know, in a way that makes Glynn
irritated?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, the thing is the tone of the show, even though it's about ideas and objects. In fact, one of the things in the very beginning was the catchphrase I had was 99% invisible, nothing personal. because I really wanted it to be about ideas, but I wanted those ideas and I wanted the objects and the things that we cover, which because we cover design, so it's really the built world in every way. But it's about finding the humanity in the built world and recognizing all these things that you take for granted, they were made for you by someone who fundamentally cared about you. And that's the feeling of the show, is about infusing all the objects around us with the humanity of intent. And so that is the spell that we try to cast. And it isn't about personal storytelling in that way, although sometimes those show up, of course. It's really about creating this space where you can enjoy and wonder about the world. Because this is the trajectory of the show it did that to me as the maker of the show. I became more aware, I became more empathic, I became just more sensitive to all these things in the world. And it seems to work. We never talked about that as the intent. It was never like part of a mission statement that went out. People just gathered that from the shows. And so you create that space through showing joy, exhibiting joy, exhibiting some kind of passion. I do go in and interpret things for people, but a lot of it is because to make these ideas come to life, you need geeky enthusiasm. And most of the time, the subject that you're interviewing can provide that. And if they don't provide it, oh, I'll provide it. because I can get into anything. Like, I love a lot of things. And so, and when we're doing a story, I'm the biggest fan of that idea or concept as it goes on. So that's very much, it's very much told from a point of view. Now, the point of view has expanded as the voices have expanded, but we still come at it from as a design column in certain ways. It certainly has facts, but we do provide a perspective. And I like that. I was free to do that for the first time because I'd been a reporter for a long time and that wasn't allowed. And I remember even in the beginning days of Snap Judgment, you know, we'd present a story. This is before any relationship with NPR had happened or anything like that, and they'd come back with their journalism questions, like, did this happen like this? What time of day? You know, like that sort of thing. And we would go, it's not really that kind of story.
Drive me nuts.
And so, so I like the role as a commentator. I mean, we really play with it. I mean, the reason the show is great in this way that it's a series over time. So no one episode has to represent our philosophy of design or our philosophy of radio or anything. You're just looking to like do the next one, and that has a little different feel. The next one has a little different feel, and over time, this like regression plot is formed, and you're like you draw a line, and that is the thesis of 99% Invisible, and I love that as an ongoing series. Like that was totally new to me, because I had these big shows that take their like five stories, they're really hard to do. It was really nice to have one that was like, this is very unusual for us. Let's just put it out there and see what it does. Because we know the next week it'll be something new. So
what both of you are describing and your shows, it would be really easy to do, to make terrible, terrible shows from the concepts that you're, right? Like you, you're exceptional at what you do, and that's why it's good. And I think that...
Oh, we've done that too.
You know, I feel like if I tried to make one of your shows, like that's I would be on
that's the feeling.
I would be on the floor.
That's Tuesday for us.
Yeah.
So
that's me and me. That's yeah. Those are both me. This panel is from that's my studio in Mexico City, which is where I drew Radio and Illustrated Guide in 1999. And that was my method of coming up with stories at that point, was to lie on the floor and groan for a few weeks. which is why doing that book was such an important turning point for me, because Ira had a system. He had whatever, and didn't apply exactly to what I was doing, but it was a system, and it had parts, and there's an order to things and all this stuff, and it was like the beginning of a whole, 10-year like investigation into how I wanted to tell stories and how I wanted to teach other people to tell stories. And all of it is about staying off that rug. I feel like still, I always have a rug in my studio just in case. And I feel like everybody I talk to practically in the radio book goes through that stage, not literally on the rug, but like that feeling of like, oh my God, how am I gonna get this thing done? And I don't understand how this is gonna go, and I'm crappy at my job, and the story sucks, and...
Do you
guys have that? Because I didn't ask you about it.
Sure, the thing is you have a deadline, and so you just do it.
Yes, you do, yes, that's true, but...
Yeah, no, you feel them. I feel them less because I pay other people to feel that for me. But
oh, I'd like to do that.
but it is, you do have those moments, but one of the things you do is you just soldier through it and realize that most of it is just, I don't believe in inspiration. You just do things.
Oh, absolutely.
Thank you for that.
Yeah.
The what makes the show happen is ass power. And by that, I mean you have to sit your ass down there until it's done. And that's so many times.
Well, that's why I think I was on the rug, is because I was waiting for inspiration. And not because I wanted to wait for inspiration, because I didn't know what else to do. I didn't have a system. Like, I didn't have a way to go about it, you know what I mean? I think I knew even then that inspiration was bunk, in that way. But it's like, and this is one of the parts of the book that I felt the most strongly about including is this idea of the German forest that comes from Jad Abumrad, and he calls it the German forest. Everybody goes, why German? And it's because he came up with this idea when he was working on a story about Wagner, so. Thus, German. So I just go around calling it the dark forest so it's a little bit more clear. But this idea of like, it's not that you have no ideas, not that you're just waiting for inspiration, but you have like, you've done a bunch of work, you have all this stuff, you have the material, you have all your research, but you don't, you don't know what the path is. You know, you have this stuff and you don't know how to put it in order. I feel like that's as much of a, it's like maybe even like a greater problem with your kind of stories, Roman, than yours, Glynn. Because Glynn, your stories are often like, they're chronological. You know, you've got, you know, you're telling a story in a certain order because it happened in that order. And maybe you change things around a little bit for suspense, but basically, you know, there's something suggested to you from the beginning. But when you're talking about an idea or an abstract concept, it's like, you know.
Yeah. I mean, the way that I do it is I just pick my favorite part. It's not the beginning. It's not the middle. It's the end. It's just something that I'm inspired to do. It could be a piece of music that I was like, I really want to talk over that piece of music, and I'll just start there. And just whatever it is, and then it starts to form. Because, I mean, I'm really adamant about the thing lives in audio, and so it's always reacting to the audio that comes before it or after it. And so once you start with one part, it just starts to coalesce, because you're going to have to react to the thing that the person said. And it can't be dry, and it can't be just the idea of what they said. It really is about the feeling and the emotion of what they said in some way. And then it just all starts to form, and then it all starts to form, and it's massive. And then you just start cutting it. It's just like, it just works. I mean, it's, you know, it's, and the other luxury that I've had recently is, because there's enough ass power on the show, we if one isn't working at all, we just stop. That, I didn't have that luxury 5 years ago. If I started a story, it was getting done. Like, it was going to be on the air. But now, we just, if we get to a point, it's just not, we're not feeling anything for it. It just goes. Sometimes you just can't work your way out of it.
I
was going to say, that happens to us all the time. It happens to me. You would be surprised that on my own radio show, less than a third of my stories make it.
Of your own stories?
Of my own stories.
Yeah.
And I don't appreciate it. but
I remember being like, we're like 4 minutes short, Glynn. Think of something from your weird life.
So that, thank God. Thank God those days are largely over. It used to be that they would come running in. The show's got to go out Thursday morning. It's Wednesday night. We need a cult story, quick. And that stinks. But now the process, though, being able to trust the producers and everything like that to make sure that everyone's got to go through the same thing, and that if the story doesn't work, you just pull it. And also time as well, like, because the stories are so labor intensive that you really do get to the point. It's like, oh, we've done all this work, and it still stinks. Can't we, someone give it something stat? But sometimes you have to let even those stories you've put everything into go. And that's hard, and hopefully we're doing it less and less, but it still happens on a monthly basis.
It's a healthy thing. When you're killing stories, you know that you're doing it right, actually. I think it's a good sign. Don't do less than, you should let them go.
Oh, you gotta
once a month's good.
You gotta let them go, but oh.
Yeah, it's painful, but.
So, I wanted to talk about the edit, which I think you started.
This is, yeah.
We started to.
That's a Glynn quote right there.
the quote, I think what I was talking about was that because the show is so, moves so quickly, we have to, you just worked on this thing and you've given birth to this story. This is a brand new thing. What do you think about my brand new story baby thingy? And we have to say, your baby's ugly. Your brand new baby's ugly. And that stinks for everybody and it hurts people's feelings. And the idea, but we have, because the you have to, we got, it's a weekly show, it's something that has to happen. And especially as a new producer, it's really tough to get that type of feedback and not take it personally.
Yeah, and I just want to paint a picture, and I want you all to put yourself in there as the new producer who's put everything into a story. And this is the room, right? The edit?
The old room.
The
yeah.
old room.
The old office, yeah.
Yeah.
And talk about how long are some of are the edits?
This morning, for example.
Yes, this morning. A session can go for 2 or 3 hours, but I mean, at its core, what you're doing is saying, let's give you've got a bunch of champion storytellers in the room, let's listen to it early and see if there's anything that comes out and if we can fix it. We're encouraged, like here, to say, it's not just my product, it's everybody's project. Cut this story to ribbons. If something's bad, go after it. And that can, especially when you're the lead producer, that's painful. Because, thank God, the reason why it's painful is because they care. They care about the product. They care about the story, and they care about the people they're going to listen to.
Even if the story's good, that, you know, it's not just like, oh, let's, you know, take apart the bad stories and put them, you know, like this is my biggest sort of revelation from working on this book, because for some reason I kind of missed the importance of this stage when I did Radio and Illustrated Guide. And I realized, you know, doing the book and after the book, that this is something I do in my own practice. Like, I talk to my husband, Matt, who's also a cartoonist, and get feedback from him, and he helps me work through problems, he critiques stuff. But also, it's what I taught in my classes. You know, when I would teach a class, and I call it critiquing, not edits, which can be confusing for people who are not in the radio world, because it doesn't mean literally editing, it means that critique process. But that's what I teach in my classes. I would have, you know, I would put stuff up on the walls and we'd all talk about it and we'd try to be as honest as possible and fix things and all that other stuff. And I would always say to my students, this is the best time of your life is right now, because you have all these people here who care and who are paying attention and who are gonna make you better. And it may be painful, but you've gotta listen. You've gotta pay attention to what they're saying. They don't necessarily have it exactly right, but you've got to listen, because this is where you understand what's actually, what's coming through of your intention, like what of the things that you're trying to do is actually happening in other people's minds.
But just to be clear, we're still talking about 2 to 3 hours of the knives being out on someone's...
Not necessarily the same story. This is for a story session. And we have, and I've learned to break that up a little bit.
But I mean, you know, like, I've talked to plenty of people at different shows, and like, they can do, it's easy to have an entire afternoon on one 20-minute story. Like, that can happen.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I think weekly for us, for sure.
Yeah.
When I talked to you, you were basically alone. You were still, I mean, Sam was still across the country.
Yeah.
But you were saying, I really miss this. This is, you know, the thing that you wanted to incorporate.
Yeah, I mean, at the time, I mean, I was lucky that I'd been edited so much that I was functioning for a short while as my own editor. This is not recommended. But I just had enough, and the stakes were just so low that it didn't really matter all that much. I mean, but now, Katie Mingle came in. We call her the cutter. and she really has a sense. I think she fundamentally believes in her core that every story would be better 2 or 3 minutes shorter. Every story. So you have to, and her goal is to make it as good as possible. Right. And she's very compassionate about it, for the most part. but we have huge edit sessions, and we do it on paper a couple of times, and we listen to it. And it's an arduous process.
Yeah.
But it's a great process.
It is a great process. And I want to say this, because one of our producers, Julia DeWitt, did a story this morning, and I loved it. I can't wait for the world to hear this story. And because of that, now we're giving it extra editing, because we think it's going to be really, really amazing. And it's not like, and it's like, oh, you, we love the story, now you're free. Oh, no. You get extra, because this is going to be a home run story, and I'll be damned if we let you down and somehow miss something to not push this story to its nth degree. So she came out of it going, they said they really liked it. I'm toast because I have to get all these edits in.
Right.
But it's going to be wonderful, and I'm really proud of her. She did a great job.
I think that's exactly what happened with the piece we're going to feature in a minute, like with the Texas versus Texas. You guys were really excited about that piece. It's a great piece, but it was a tough edit. It was like a long, you know, it's a long, hard thing, and that's a, you know, that I depict in the book.
I mean, I think I'm a little bit stuck on like the personal feelings when you're putting your creative energies into this thing, and then any criticism can be taken.
Yeah.
How do you?
I mean, sometimes in the room, you can't really take it, is the thing. And then later on, when you're going back to fix the things, that you go, oh, I guess I'll do it a little bit more their way, and then figure out a path. It might not be the exact edit that is being asked for, but you can sort of like, as you're working through it, you start to find the solution in a way. I have that issue.
Oh, shit. Sorry.
Like, for example, I really wanted an elephant in this story. And Jessica was like, I don't think an elephant really is.
That's not the built world.
Yeah.
Does not fit.
I know. But I really wanted it.
That's the thing, is that people, like the people who are giving you that critique, they don't necessarily know what the answer is, but they can help you identify what doesn't work.
Yeah.
They can tell you what isn't working. And even then, like, and this is something Ira said to me when I was interviewing him, is like, you go from, you know, somebody can say, oh, well, this little moment didn't work, this piece of tape didn't work, I didn't get it, I don't know why it's important, and that's your favorite piece, it's the best thing, and that means you didn't set it up right. You know, it doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with that tape. It means that there's something wrong before or after or something, that there's, you know, and identifying how to fix these things is tricky. It's not necessarily, I mean, if you have the cutter on your staff, perhaps you have, you know, the sort of expert help you need to make all those things work. But like in many cases, you just have people who are like, well, I don't really know, but they're helping you understand what's working, what's
yeah.
not.
Yeah, we don't always know the answer, but we try to figure it out, which is why some of those sessions are so epic. I need them in a lot of ways, but in particular, I'm like a huge radio fan. And so if I really like something, I can just bliss out, just like I'll keep listening to it. And so I kind of don't have the temperament to be a very good editor. And so it's really good to have people listen with you, and also to play your stuff out loud. Like, the key to that is not just what people tell you, is that when you hear your work in front of other people and there's something wrong with it, you feel it when you're in the room. Like, my ears get red and my head gets really hot, you know, and I just feel miserable, and they don't have to say anything, and I'll know exactly what has to go.
So
I think that's actually something that people in other media really need to learn, because the advantage you guys have doing audio is it's going to be out loud.
Yeah.
Like, at some point, even if you're writing a script, at some point you're going to say it out loud, and that saying it out loud is a really, really important stage of understanding, because you're right, you can hear it yourself. Even if you're just talking alone in a room, much better if somebody's there, but like, even by yourself, you can tell if your sentence structures aren't working, or if you can't explain a thing or whatever. And actually, because of doing this book, I started, when I talk to Matt about various story problems I have, I'll usually tape it, because often I can say something, I'm trying to figure out what I want to say, and I'll say it the right way, but if I don't have it on tape, then I won't be able to go write it later.
Right. Everything I do, I talk out loud for, and I don't write the script, I say the script, I kind of transcribe the script, and then I try to make it right. And it's really critical. I do it so much that when I'm out in the world, thank God for cell phones now, but when I'm out in the world, I just talk to myself so much. that I forget that other people are around. But it's just part of the process, is talking through that thing.
This is something I actually stole from This American Life, is this whole idea. Oftentimes, when you are editing and you go through a piece and you're not quite sure what it is, it's just not clean enough, it's not perfect enough, it's not right enough, there's something wrong, I'll be the jerk that just do this better.
That is totally an Ira thing.
Yeah, do that part better.
Do a better job.
Do a better job right here. And it's not like... It's not like you screwed it up necessarily, it's just like, there's something not clean about it. And they don't appreciate it, but it's like what Roman was saying, this, you get to the point where it's not hitting a rhythm, a beat, it's not clean enough, it's not, whatever it is, it's just not working, but you know that it's, whatever they're doing, it's necessary. So fix it. and oftentimes that it's the worst edit, but it's the best because you can fix it your way. And if I tell them how to fix it, I might be wrong, but I know that there's a problem.
So that's actually, I mean, that's a little bit similar to you were saying, you want the listener to interpret the story for themselves, and you want...
Let me talk out of both sides of my mouth. This is really a big deal. We're trying to make cinema of sound. We want to make movies of the mind, and we actually, in a different way than say Roman does, or let's say TAL, any other show, they are oftentimes in the hunt for great tape. This is awesome tape. We'll build around it. We oftentimes at Snap decide we're going to make our own tape. I'm going to come up with a story idea, and then I'm going to build that story idea. And oftentimes with the person, like if we go out and interview someone, it's almost the same thing. There's a lot of artifice to this. If you interview someone for 5 hours, and you're going to do a 7-minute piece, you have a lot of latitude on what the story arc looks like. But what I love about it is that at the end of the day, almost invariably, the person will come back and say, I can't believe I told that story so well. You didn't. You didn't. There's been certain stories, I think there was one maybe when you were there where I thought someone's gonna get in trouble. Someone in radio is going to get in trouble, hopefully not us, but there was not one word that was said in the order that we presented it in this on a particular sentence.
There was just one.
but you're getting at the truth of what that piece was. I'm just saying all that to say that we're the stories themselves. The person who's putting those pieces together is essentially a writer of the story. And that's a fact that the producer takes so much control over it that it becomes a new expression after the interview is done.
It's true. We're writers of other people's works.
Dirty,
absolutely
dirty little secret, or
I don't know if it's a dirty secret, but it's definitely what we do, and I'm not a very good writer just on the page. Like I don't enjoy that process. But if you give me a transcript of somebody, I love to craft that into the right story for them.
So do you feel like you're helping them say what they're trying to say more effectively?
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, if you do it right, I mean, you could make them say something differently, and that would be right for them. And oftentimes, because of various ethical codes and ethic codes, you never want to give a person final edit unless you think you... I never let them necessarily have final right over the final product. But certain times, I'll think, I'm not necessarily sure we're getting this part right. Did you really say it like this? Am I putting words in your mouth? Because that's something we never want to have someone say, I never said that, because they might have a point. And we got to be really, really careful and make sure that at least we're capturing the spirit of where they were coming from.
I want to make sure that we have time for audience questions. There was a lot more that we had planned to talk about, but I want you to have an opportunity to ask questions too. So I want to end my portion of this by having, I'm curious, Jessica, will you tell us about this slide?
This is the last spread of the book, and the epilogue of the book, you know, we're talking about stories about ideas, and so Out on the Wire is a book about ideas. It's a book about concepts and tools and has some stories in it, but basically it's about that. But so when I got to the end of it, I was like, well, there's no conclusion. It's just like, here's the stuff, you know, I already gave it to you. So the epilogue is more about how it felt for me as the writer to, and the cartoonist, to go through the process of learning all of these things. And then feel like at the end that I did emerge from the dark forest, you know, which was very dark and very long period of time. But when I got out the other side, I felt like, wow, I've really, like, I know something new. Like, I've learned something new. And the metaphor of going out on the wire comes from Jay Allison, and he was talking about storytellers on the moth, and he's talking about editing them, literally editing, not an edit critique. But and he was saying basically he doesn't edit them. All he does is basically take out swear words, and that's pretty much it. Because what he values the most is those moments when people pause, when they hesitate, because those pauses, that it indicates thinking. You know, it shows people struggling with something. And you know, comics and radio are so weirdly parallel in this way, because comics has two tracks that you read them on. You read the words and you read the pictures. And the pictures have a direct line to your subconscious. You understand things about what you're looking at without ever thinking about it. But although radio only has, literally it only has one track in the sense, I mean, has dozens and dozens of tracks, I know, but like when it comes in your ears, it's coming in, you know, just those two earbuds. But at the same time, it has two tracks, or I see it as having two tracks, because it has the sort of vocal, narrative, interview stuff that's going on, and then it has the nonverbal sound, which can be as complex as what you guys build, but it can be as simple as breath. You know, it can be as simple as just, you know, little background noises and just noise in the tape, and that we absorb all those things and understand them, and it's part of the emotional resonance of audio, you know. So when Jay was talking about going out on the wire, he was saying, like, people have to take that risk. They have to allow themselves to be vulnerable, and that moment when they pause and they think and they consider whether they're really going to do this thing, are they really going to get out there and take a risk, that's going out on the wire. And I thought that is, like, you know, when I was looking for a title for the book, I just thought that it is the essential truth of all of these great producers and the pieces that they make, is that they have to take some kind of emotional risk themselves, or, you know, they have to care enough about what they're doing and get out on the wire with it, and that's what makes it really great.
Thank you. So we have microphones on either side of the audience. We have time for a few questions. And while you're getting to your questions, I just want to take a minute. There's some 99% invisible staff and Snap Judgment staff, KALW and KQD storytellers. Will you stand up so we can applaud you? Anyone who makes stories, thank you. And we have a question from the Stanford Storytelling Project.
Right here. Hi. So I recently returned home And I interviewed my eighth grade geometry teacher about his experiences in Vietnam. And it's great tape, but it's really important to me that I get this right after I left back. For here, he was actually hospitalized, and I really want to make sure that I leave a great lasting impression of him. And I just want some advice on how to not screw this up, how to make this good.
I think I would ask, get it right for what?
Well, for both the story and for him, it's some heavy material.
Yeah. Serve the story and you'll serve him. That's what I think.
A question.
Roman and Glynn, I'm wondering if you can talk about where your stories come from, especially you've both been on the air or making stories for quite a long time now, so maybe in comparison of when you were getting the ball rolling and it was kind of more of a blank slate, and then, you know, five, and I'm not sure how long Snap's been running, but however many years later, and, you know, maybe how many you're working on at once.
I think we did very different processes, yeah. but I'll say for Snap in general, we're probably working about 4 months ahead of time, at any given time, and everyone's in the staff is using different processes as well. My stories generally start off as I write a story at the beginning of the thing that's going to be personal to lead people into the episode. If I do a story within the show, that too will oftentimes be personal, or it might be something that I make up entirely. A Wizard of Oz story, Superman, whatever it may be. But we're trying, it's just people are going through documentary films, they're going through Irish newspapers. They are, a guy was trying to tell me a story in the restroom. It's a good story. So, but there's so many different ways to do it. I think that the producers really have their antenna up for wherever they're going. It's something you just do all the time.
Yeah, I mean, one of the things about design as a beat is that the stories are kind of everywhere, and you can kind of use as a lens to do a lot of things. So that was built into the design of the show in general, was like a way that I could talk about all the things I liked and still have it have a theme, but not really have a theme, you know? So ideas are kind of easy for us. We have a lot of them. They're always looking, the staff is always looking. We get pitches, but it just sort of takes, because we cover mundane things, we try to find the exciting little detail about something that moves us about a mundane thing. We just look for those things that kind of put us over the edge of, like, the ones that really work are the ones that, if you hear the story, you decode the world a little bit differently after you hear it. And those are the things that kind of put us over the edge to make us greenlight something. But story ideas, those are easy. And if you're doing a show or doing a series, make sure that it feels that those parts are easy, because the hard part is turning those into something. That's really the limiting factor. Cool. And we work probably 2 months ahead, not four, that's for sure.
So we have time for two more questions. We'll take one right here.
I should say that the first episode of the Out on the Wire podcast is about finding ideas, if that's something you're wondering about.
Roman, my question is about the narrators in your show. So you start off as the host, and you've maintained a consistent voice and a consistent sound as you've added Avery and Sam and Katie and more voices narrating. And I was wondering how you maintain that balance. I imagine it's a little bit delicate because you're always the main voice, but sometimes somebody else is really telling most of the story. And I was wondering how you maintain that balance and sound while also, you know, bringing in new voices and highlighting new talent.
Well, I mean, I take great pride in that. I think the fact that you know Katie and Avery and Sam means a lot to me, honestly, because I was an unknown producer for a very long time, and it means a lot to me that their voices they're known as characters in the show, and that's very intentional. And we have that, I think, even greater than most shows that exist, even though I'm like in all those shows. I mean, like I'm like in throughout popping up. And we just divide it up so that I do the signposting and any reflections that are sort of relate to me. But now, like, they work on a piece and they write my parts. I mean, not all the time, but a lot of the time. And they'll go like, you should, you know, they'll like, I'll get like a thing like, you know, like, I think Katie wrote me for this fortune cookie one. It was just like, do you have an experience with fortune cookies that I could use here? And the answer is no, I really didn't have one. But they look for those things, and we just divide it up so that a lot of it has to do with the rhythm of just the ear, just like, someone needs to say something, and just switch it up. But mainly, I do the parts that are like, here's a fact, here's a statement of where we are in the world, and they do an interpretation and a feeling or something from where they are at that moment. I don't pretend I'm at a place I'm not at. You know, we have sort of rules the way it works, but we just kind of go by gut for what sounds right.
Last question over here.
Hi, my question is about what you see coming up next for public radio. You both talked about how radio now can be cinematic. And when you think about cinematic history, there are phases. There's new wave cinema. There's realist cinema. There's sort of waves that happen. I'm wondering if you do sort of see a new wave happening, or that there's something that you'd like to see happen in the future of public radio.
Yeah. Wow. I mean, I think that I don't know what we want to call public media per se, but there is so much change afoot right now that the viability of the sort of podcast revolution has unleashed. If I were starting off today, there is no way I would ever start an NPR show. No way. When you have so much, there's the ability to get to an audience through podcasting, and now that advertiser supported, even you can get to, if you can hit 40,000 listeners, which is a lot of people, but it's nowhere near the types of thresholds that had to be hit in the past. And you can do it in a lot of different, very innovative ways, especially if you're making good stuff. There is so much opportunity right now to get out there and tell stories in different ways. And it used to be, even like 5 years ago, next week, I'm going to the Public Radio Program Directors Conference, and I hate it. I hate it because it's a bunch of people who have been the gatekeepers of what people got to listen to. And their significance is going away. You do not need them anymore to tell you what you're going to listen to anymore, and it is wonderful. It is really, really wonderful. Roman, you tell them what you do. Yes, I'm jealous. I am jealous. So, yes.
Yeah, I think that he's right. The opportunity is totally different now. And it really changed so rapidly. I think one of the things that's really amazing about Jessica's book is the first one with This American Life, about 80% of those people are still where they are, like Julie and Nancy and Ira, and they do the show, and it's basically the same show. I think it's developed a lot with their journalism has really, I think I'm the most amazed by when they take on a story that they never would have done 15 years ago, and those are the best shows for me. But I think what's notable about the new book is, you know, Alex is interviewed for Planet Money. Now he's Gimlet. I was interviewed with Snap Judgment. Now I do 99. We've moved around so much because the opportunities have changed so drastically. Like, you really can make it on your own in a new way. And I think that process of the distribution and the ways you can make money and the ways you can support your show, I believe that fundamentally will make more interesting radio over time. I think that because you can have those 50,000 core listeners and support your show, it's a whole different ballgame. And I can't wait to see what happens. I'm a huge podcast listener. I love new shows. And when there's new ones, there's no one more excited than I am. So I think it's a great time.
Thank you. So I want to, one of the great new podcasts is Jessica's. It's also called Out on the Wire, and it is, there's two episodes that are out so far, and it's how to do this, how to tell stories, and you should all sign up, and you should all buy her book and use it as your text. You should all join us for wine and some snacks while Jessica signs your book. So thank you for coming. Thank you, Jessica Roman.
Thank you.